We thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship and spend time with you, Father. We're grateful that you usher us into your presence. Bless this time and use it, Father. May you be exalted and glorified in and through all that is done. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Chelsea?
All right. Well, welcome, everyone. You could all stand. And we introduced this song last week, but it's called Great Things. And isn't it wonderful that he has done great things even through everything that's been going on? He's done great things, is doing great things, and will be doing great things. All right, so let's begin.
Thank you. captured me. Your grace has set me free. Your life, the air I breathe, be glorified in me. You set my feet to dancing. You set my heart on fire.
Sunday school, to where when something kind of doesn't go your way and God causes turmoil or anything in your life, what do you do to still praise Him? And we kind of actually came to this song to where at the beginning it says, "Be still and there is a healer." So I want this to be your prayer for this week, is with everything that's going on or what's going on in your life, just be still in His presence and that you know that He has you in His hands.
Let faith arise.
Well, good morning, South End Baptist Church. Good to see you this morning. If you're wondering who that masked man is, Jason and Beth Lang here. Many of you are home folk and know us. Some of you perhaps are wondering who we are. We are missionaries sent out by South End Baptist Church to Nicaragua and had the privilege of serving here at South End as associate pastor for about 7 years back in, 2004 to 2011. And so God's given us the opportunity to come back several times and visit. I think just about 2 years ago to date, we were here visiting with you guys during 2018. And if we didn't quite seem like ourselves, it's probably because we were not. We were going through some a difficult season in life and ministry at the time. And God was working in our hearts and in our ministry, in our family, in the country of Nicaragua. A lot was going on, but we're thankful to be here this time, and we just want to start off by saying thank you. Thank you for being our sending church, for being one of our supporting churches. You guys have been faithfully supporting us for about 10 years, and we're very grateful for that. We thank you for your prayers. As all of us sitting in the room here this morning know, life is hard, and we get thrown some really big curveballs sometimes, and it's no different in another country. Life is hard in another country as well. Ministry is hard, but God is faithful. And we're just glad that we have the opportunity to share a little bit with you this morning.
So A couple of people have asked, can you hear me okay, everybody? Okay. A few people have asked how long we've been back in the States. We arrived back just before July 4th. It was a little later than scheduled. We had about 5 canceled flights due to closed airports and COVID. And if you want to hear the whole story, you can catch us later. It's always fun to update you on our kids. I won't make them stand up. Their pictures are on the screen. You've probably seen them walking around this morning. They're up here at the front, but they have grown and they've gotten really tall. So they do like to play basketball, all of them. But I shared earlier this morning that it's just incredible how the kids that were in youth when we were here are now having their own kids. In fact, I met Jessica's little girl just before the service this morning. It was really sweet. And now our kids are youth age. It's crazy how time passes. It goes by really fast. But this morning we wanted to share with you a few things about what's been happening in Nicaragua just over several years. And we thought we would do it this way. When teams come down from the United States, we often ask them a couple of questions. What was a high and what was a low, maybe from your day or from your week? And it helps us kind of get a pulse on what are they noticing? What are they thinking about what's going on here in Nicaragua? And so that's the way that we would like to share with you this morning. We want to share a couple of highs over the last 8 years in Central America and a couple of lows, just to help you get a pulse on how things have been going and what's been happening in the ministry. So we'll start with the highs.
Start on a positive note. And many of you have heard about this ministry, but in end of 2014, beginning of 2015, I know that's been a while, right? 5 years. Long time now. God gave us the awesome opportunity of developing a camp ministry for kids and for youth. I don't know how many people here in the room have been to a camp at some point in time. Maybe it was a weekend retreat, or maybe it was a week-long youth camp or summer camp. But we had the opportunity to develop a camp ministry, an evangelistic, share the gospel of Christ with kids and youth. And that we had the opportunity to begin developing that in 2015. We had an all-volunteer staff, and I don't remember the number of camps that we offered that year, but it was substantial. 2016, took another step. We actually hired a part-time staff. Young Nicaraguan college-age students were our staff. They were counselors. They were running games. They were leading small groups, doing skits, leading music, all those things you do at camp. 2017 took another step. We were able to take all those part-time staffers on, full-time staff. And in our last full year, 2017, last full year of camp ministry, God allowed us to see just under 8,000 campers come through the camp ministry. And we, to our knowledge, according to our records, somewhere around 1,000 campers made some sort of decision for Christ. It was an awesome ministry. It was a growing ministry. It was the highlight of our ministry. And so we'll leave you with that high point right there.
As I'm standing up here this morning and thinking about camp ministry, one quick thought and memory comes to mind. I think about VBS here and how much fun it was. And children's camp there was kind of like VBS on steroids. It was just crazy, but a whole lot of fun. So another thing that came out of the camp ministry that we really didn't expect in the beginning was what we saw happening with the camp staff. Jason mentioned that the camp staff were young Nicaraguans, kind of mostly 20-somethings, that had graduated from high school, some of them, and had college classes. And we had about 15 that were paid staff, and then we had some volunteers. And we started to see in them that they were growing spiritually, they were learning more about ministry. We kind of became like a family. In fact, some of them even started to call us mom and dad. And we really began to see the potential in these young people that, wow, they really are going to be the leaders in the Nicaraguan church. And they could be leaders in the community, possibly even the government of Nicaragua one day. And we saw that God was really showing us something in our hearts and giving us a desire to help them grow. And so that's where That was another blessing that we saw come out of that camp ministry that we really didn't expect, but it was a very special blessing.
So the two highs, just camp ministry, reaching out to a lot of kids and youth with the gospel, and then number two, camp staff, which was more of a personal discipleship kind of relationship. So those are the two highs. There's more, but we're just going to share two for this morning. Now for the lows. Last time we saw you guys was in 2018, and we were back in the United States because Nicaragua had been literally going crazy, all right? There was a social political crisis that would take me the next hour to really explain to you well. But it caused a lot of things to fall apart in the country. And it caused a lot of things to just be questionable, uncertain. And so as we started 2018, we had a lot of dreams, a lot of hopes for the camp ministry that year. We were always tweaking it, trying to make it better. And in April of 2018 is when the social political crisis hit. And it hit, and within about 5 days, the country was gone completely sideways. You guys have seen some similar things in the news in Portland, in Kenosha, in Washington, in Atlanta. So just imagine those things. Just bring that down to the state level. And instead of all across a big, huge country, all across the state, so it's in Frederick, it's in Baltimore, it's in Annapolis, it's in Hagerstown. Everywhere kind of close to where you live is going crazy. And so we had to suspend the camp ministry. Interesting thing, every year we developed a theme for the camp ministry so we could just have a focus for the kids. Our theme for 2018 that we came up with based on Psalm 46:10 was along the lines of be still and know God. We called it tiempo fuera, which means time out. The idea was for kids and youth to take a time out and come to know God, to really know Him. We didn't know that the camp ministry was going to have to take a time out. And that was hard. Something we've been investing heavily in for 3.5 years, and all of a sudden we have to take a time out, and we're really not sure if it's going to be able to start back or not.
So as we were here in 2018, things began happening. There were some meetings with our higher-ups and the people that funded this camp ministry, and it looked like the camp ministry would be able to continue again in 2019. So when we returned in January of 2019, we were ready to go, started meeting with some of the camp staff to start making plans for new camp year because it normally started in February or March. And we got to March of that year, 2019, and found out that some things had changed and that foundation would no longer be able to fund the camp ministry. Well, in Nicaragua, you can't ask campers to pay for camp. They might could pay equivalent to 50 cents or a dollar, but that's not enough to fund a camp ministry. And so that was one of our other low points when we realized that God was closing that door on that ministry. And we were kind of not sure what to do from there. But of course, there's just always lots of ministry to be done, right? And so we have a video we'd like to show you of some of the things that we've been busy with over the last couple of years. And after the video, we'll share with you where God is leading us in the future.
So of our kind of main primary ministry, God's given us plenty of other opportunities, including, believe it or not, me serving as the interim pastor of a Nicaraguan church to start off this year. In case you're wondering, yes, I do speak Spanish. Let me just share with you briefly, moving forward, obviously COVID has turned all of our lives upside down, at least temporarily, if not longer than that. So we've done a lot of praying and soul searching over the past few months, and we feel like God's leading us to a new opportunity to work with, in partnership, with another organization. We'll continue to serve with ABWE, but in partnership with Word of Life International, in a school called English for Life. English for Life is a one-year intensive English as a second language program for high school graduates. So we'll be working with those 20-somethings that we've already mentioned. And it's an opportunity. They live on the campus. They receive English classes in the morning, Bible classes in the afternoon. It's open to students from churches that are saved and know the Lord. It's open to students who are lost and who need to be saved. And so it's a tremendous opportunity to share the gospel to those who are lost and disciple those who are saved, so that this next generation of young people are better fit and better suited to be leaders in the country, in the church, and in their communities. And so we're pretty excited about this opportunity to serve in leadership of this institute. And Lord willing, we'll be returning in January 2021, and we'll be starting this new ministry pretty much right away, with classes starting probably in March or April of 2021.
So if you'd like to hear more about the English for Life Institute or more about what God's doing in Nicaragua, please just get in touch with us. We can set up a time to talk to you. Again, as a church, we thank you for your partnership in the ministry, and many of you as individuals or families also partner with us. If you don't know, the way our mission works is we have financial partners that give monthly to support the ministry there. And right now we are at around 80-some% of what we need. And part of our January return is contingent on getting back to 100% of the support that we need. And so if anyone is interested in partnering with us in the ministry, please catch up with us afterwards. We'd be glad to talk to you, or send us a message on Facebook or whatever way you would like to. Also, we left some prayer cards out in the Welcome Center. If you would like to pick up one of those on your way out, we'd love for you to do that so you can pray. If you run out, just let us know. We've got plenty.
Well, thank you for letting us share a little bit about the ministry. I hope that's been encouraging to you. God is at work. I know sometimes it doesn't seem like it, and with COVID and rioting and all the political mudslinging that's going on right now. But God's at work. There has never been a day where God has not been seated on his throne and in control of everything. Doesn't always feel that way. On a personal level, doesn't always feel that way. Oftentimes we kind of live life with questions. What's God doing? What's he up to? Why this? Why that? And the interesting thing is, God is really not so interested in answering all our questions. He's really more interested in just having a relationship with us. Just walking and talking and doing life with God. And that's really what I want to talk about this morning. A little bit of a different sermon format for me. I normally would just say, hey, turn your Bibles to this passage, and we'd dig right into that passage. But this morning, I actually want to jump around a little bit. We will start off, I think Jennifer's got Mark 16:15 up here. That's one of the Great Commission passages. But turn with me, if you would, to Matthew chapter 28. Very familiar Great Commission passage. You say, well, why is it called the Great Commission? It's because that's what Jesus left for his disciples to do. And if you're a follower of Jesus this morning, you're one of his disciples, and so he left this job for you to do as well. It wasn't just for the 12. It was for all disciples, all followers of Christ. And what it says in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 and 20, Jesus says, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Now, there's a whole lot, really, that can be unpacked right there in that passage. But I want to focus in on what I believe, what Beth and I have been learning, to be kind of the heart of the mission, the heart of the mission that Christ has given us. A lot of times, and it's very tempting to do this, not necessarily during COVID, because nobody really wants to go anywhere right now. But normally, under normal circumstances, as a missionary, I would want to stand up here, and I would kind of like to emphasize the go. Come on down to Nicaragua and serve with us. And we actually would love for you to come down and serve with us in Nicaragua. But a lot of times, that's where the emphasis is, that you need to go. You need to go. You need to go somewhere and serve Christ. But the actual text is more along the lines of, as you are going, make disciples. So the go is not the emphasis. We're all going about life. You're going to your job. You're going to school. Even if it's online, you're going, right? So as you go about life, make disciples. And something that Beth and I, and I think the kids too, to some degree, we have been learning over the past few years is that that's really where it's at. And unfortunately, in church ministry, as you recall, and many of you know, I served here at South End for almost 7 years. Church ministry in North America, pre-COVID, all right, it's very busy. Lots of events, lots of activities, full calendar. There's activities for kids, there's activities for youth, there's activities for young adults, there's activities for senior adults, there's activities for moms, there's activities for dads, there's a men's group, there's a women's group, I mean, you name it. Busy, busy, busy. And I'm not necessarily downing that, but I question it. Because what happens oftentimes when we're very busy doing ministry, we actually fail to minister to people. We're just running from one activity to another. We're just preparing for one lesson and another. And in the meantime, the people that we actually need to spend time with are kind of getting lost in the shuffle. We're still seeing them, we're still saying, hey, but we don't really know what's going on in their lives. They don't really know what's going on in ours. And when we don't know what's going on in people's lives, it's really hard for us to minister to one another. And so I want to talk about this idea of disciple making. And part of the reason why we've learned about this is Nicaragua is considered a warm culture country, all right? Let me just take a few seconds to talk about the difference between warm culture and cold culture, all right? Warm culture means it's warm all the time, all right? If you like warm weather, we have more than enough for you in Nicaragua. You come on down, we will keep you warm 24/7, 365, all right? I promise. We have two seasons, hot and hotter. Or if you want to be a little more scientific about it, we have dry season and wet and rainy season. But they're both hot, okay? But think about summer here in Frederick, Maryland. What do you do in summer? Well, you get out and you go for a hike. You go to the park. You have a picnic. You go to an amusement park. You have people over for a cookout. It's warm. You're outside. You're doing things with people. It's more relational. But as we well know, because we used to live in Thurmont, we used to call Thurmont the Windy City. I know they call Chicago Windy City, but man, it used to get windy up there. Wind, cold wind coming down off the Catoctin Mountains. And man, about this time of year, about October, about November, after the trees changed colors, we didn't care to get out too much. I mean, obviously we did. We came to church. We did our things we needed to do. But as far as like hanging outside, it got cold. And so you head inside where you can stay warm. Well, guess what? There's not too many people inside your home, right? But in Nicaragua, it's a warm culture. It's always open. People are always outside. You're driving down the road, there's people walking down the road alongside of you. There's people waiting in line at the bus station, at the bus stop. You never close your windows, so you can hear your neighbors. It's just a much more relational culture because people always have the opportunity to be out and about and talking, and they're just more relational. And I noticed, as a North American who typically had my little checklist to do, how many people like checklists? All right, sorry, I do too. I feel your pain. So, you know, you have your checklist, and so I've got to go to point A, point B, point C. I've got to do this, that, and the other. So what happens when you have that mindset? You're task-oriented, and people often get left out. And Nicaraguans have taught me about that. Because I would be on my way from point A to point B, and the guy at point A would want to talk for a few minutes. He would want to know, how you doing? How's your family? How's your family back home in the States? And I'm like, man, I ain't got time for this. I got to go do something. But over time, as they would say in Spanish, poco a poco, little by little, I began to realize that those conversations were more important than for me running off to the next thing. And so then I started asking them, hey, how you doing? How's your family? How's your kids? You know, did you see the game the other day? And just more conversational, trying to build those relationships. And that's really what discipleship is about. And I want to spend the rest of our time talking about this idea of discipleship. And I have a few points I want to share with you. Point number one is this: disciples follow Jesus. Disciples follow Jesus. It starts with salvation. Starts when we put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. That's the moment when we say, Jesus, I'm going to follow you. And that begins the process, but the process doesn't stop there. It only begins there. It's a lifelong journey from that point of following Jesus. And it has to do with denying or rejecting natural selfish desires and the normal ways of the world and adopting His desires. It's making what is important to Jesus important to you. It's about making His priorities your priorities. And it's a daily choice. Listen to what Mark says in Mark 8:34. He says, when He had called the people to Himself, with His disciples also, He said to them, whoever desires to come after Me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow Me. I love the way Mark puts it here. He says, when He had called the people to Himself. Think with me, with your knowledge of the Scriptures, ever since Genesis chapter 2, God has been calling people, men, women, to Himself. God is a relational God, and God desires to have a relationship with you. And not just at church on Sunday morning. He wants to have a relationship with you all week long, all year long, for the rest of your life. And so he called them to Himself. But listen to Luke's account of the same statement. Luke 9:23 says, then He said to them all, if anyone desires to come after Me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow Me. And I'm very thankful that Dr. Luke put in there, daily. Take up his cross daily. And follow Me. And so every day when we wake up in the morning, we have to determine as Christians, as believers, who are we going to follow today? Who are we going to serve today? Am I going to serve myself? Unfortunately, that's often the default. We often default to serving ourselves. What do I want to eat? What do I want to do? What do I want to spend my money on? Where do I want to go? And Jesus is saying, deny that and follow Me. And so the question then becomes not, what do I want to do? The question in the morning becomes, Jesus, what do You want me to do today? Now I realize a lot of times that's the same thing every day, right? It's get up and go to work. Or get up and go to school. But God has something for you to do there. He has people for you to meet. People for you to talk to. A job for you to do well as an example. And so, disciples follow Jesus. But number two, they don't just follow him where he's leading. Excuse me. Disciples also imitate Jesus. They also imitate Jesus. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. Let me ask you a question this morning. Could you say that to people? Could you say, hey, you imitate me while I imitate Jesus and we'll all be okay? I'll be honest. I have never told anybody else to imitate me as I imitate Christ. I hope that I've lived a life worthy of being imitated. Beth and I actually realized sometimes with our camp staff that we were having more influence on them than we thought because we were imitating Christ. I'll tell you this story, just a simple one. But Beth would actually, she'd come out to the camps and help lead the camp ministry for the youth and the kids. But every day at about 1:30, 2 o'clock, she would pack up and she would head into town. Camp wasn't over, but she would pack up and head into town. Why? Because she had to pick our kids up from school. She actually felt bad about that. She thought she was being a bad example by leaving camp early and leaving work to be done by the other camp staff. But you know what we found out from some of the young girls on our camp staff? That they were impressed by her love for her kids. And that she would leave and go take care of them. She was imitating Christ. And we don't always realize, but we do have to be intentional about how we live to determine what kind of influence we're going to be. Who are we really imitating? So let me just share a few areas in which we should imitate Jesus. First of all, we should imitate Jesus in our compassion. Matthew 9:36 says, but when he saw the multitudes, he, Jesus, was moved with compassion for them because they were weary and scattered like sheep, having no shepherd. When you look at the multitudes, when you watch the news, when you see what's going on in other cities and other states and other countries, all the craziness, are you moved with anger? Are you moved with compassion? And I know it's really hard. You're kind of moved by both at the same time, right? We need to be people who are moved by compassion because you know why the people are doing the things that they're doing out there in the world? Because they're lost. They're wandering around like sheep without a shepherd. They don't know what they're doing. They're serving themselves. They're doing whatever pleases them today. And so we need to have compassion like Jesus had compassion. We also need to imitate his mission. John chapter 6, verse 38 says, for I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. So again, we kind of have that wake up every morning. God, what do you want me to do? Jesus, how do I follow you today? That's what Jesus did. He did not seek to do his own will. He sought to do the will of the Father. Also need to imitate him in his humility. Philippians 2, 5 and 8, 5 through 8 says, let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. He being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Just let that passage sink in for a few seconds. Jesus, equal with God, God himself in the flesh, humbled himself. Took on the form of a servant. This is kind of one of those passages where you read it and you think, man, it sure is a good thing that I wasn't Jesus. Because I probably would not have humbled myself. I probably would have used my superpowers to take some people out. That's not what Jesus did. says he humbled himself and took on a form as a servant. And we see that again. Another area where we're to imitate is in his service. So we imitate him in humility. We imitate him in service. John chapter 13. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's. Are you talking about a humble moment when Jesus, the master of all the disciples, he gets down on his knees and washes the stinky, dirty feet of the disciples who had been walking in dusty streets with sandals? Mark chapter 10, verse 45 says, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give himself as a ransom for many." Let me just ask you a question this morning. You don't have to answer out loud. I'll probably ask a few more questions like this. Would you rather be served or serve others? It's a tough question to answer. But Jesus came to serve, and we're to imitate him in that. We're also to imitate him in his suffering. 1 Peter 2:21 says, "For this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, to leave us an example that you should follow in his steps." What steps are those? Steps of suffering. Steps of self-denial. And then we're to follow him in his obedience. Imitate his obedience. "Now by this we know that we know him if we keep his commandments." We imitate him in these ways. So disciples, disciples follow Jesus. Disciples imitate Jesus. But now I really want to get into the meat of this part, this idea of disciple making. The idea that Jesus had in mind is that disciples would make disciples who would make disciples who would make disciples, and that would continue. Right? But I think in a lot of our churches here in North America and around the world, in Nicaragua too, we have to stop and ask ourselves, how many disciples have I made? And so, disciples help others follow Jesus. Unfortunately, a lot of times we kind of stop at just ourselves trying to follow Jesus. And every day we try to follow Jesus, but we forget that part of it is to help others follow Jesus. And it starts with evangelism. It starts with preaching the message of the gospel to those who are lost. Romans chapter 10, 14 and 15. "How then shall they call on him who they have not believed? How shall they believe in him them whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher?" And you say, "Oh, that's right. We have a preacher at South End." That's not what Paul was saying. He wasn't saying that your church have a preacher. Okay? Actually, you know, here in the States, we often use the word, we talk about sharing the gospel. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But it's interesting. In Spanish, in Nicaragua, we use the word predicar, the gospel. We preach the gospel to others. And share is good, but preaching is kind of takes on a different context. It's a little more intentional. Preaching the gospel. So that others might hear. So it starts with, we help others follow Jesus through evangelism, but it doesn't stop there. Discipleship is not just a six-week course that somebody attends and then it's done. It's about helping them grow over the course of their life. Paul in Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8 says, "As you therefore have received Christ," okay, so there's the salvation part, "as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him," there's the follow, there's the imitate, "rooted and built up in him and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the men, according to the basic principles of the world, not according to Christ." And so there's this idea that as believers, we need to be rooted and built up in him. And that doesn't happen naturally. We can't teach ourselves but so much. We oftentimes need someone to come alongside us and disciple us, to mentor us, to coach us. And that looks different at different times. So for those of us who have kids, discipleship looks like helping our kids grow up in such a way where they love God and honor Him with their lives. That's discipleship. But it also looks like when you have a friend whose marriage is on the rocks and about to fall apart because there's been unfaithfulness, and all their worldly friends are saying, run, split, divorce, break up. And you're talking to this brother or sister in Christ, and you sit down with them and you say, God wants you to stay together. Because that's what really glorifies and honors God. You need to forgive your spouse. You need to work through this. God wants to restore you and use you as a testimony to others. It also looks like sitting down with maybe a high school graduate, someone who, you know, they've graduated from high school, maybe they didn't go to college right away, and they're trying to figure out, what do I do with my life? And you, because you're older and you have more experience, you sit down with them and you start talking. Hey, here's some of your options. Here's what you need to do. Well, what do you think? Should I take this job or should I take that job? This job's close. This job's further away. Helping talk through it, praying with them about that. That's discipleship. It's helping people hear God's voice and obey Him. It's about helping others follow Jesus. Paul said in Romans chapter 15, verse 14, now I myself am confident concerning you, my brethren, that you also are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, able to admonish one another. Do you know what that word admonish means? It means to build one another up. God has given us as believers the responsibility to help build one another up. Sadly, all too often in many churches, people just tear one another down. God wants us to build one another up. It's called discipleship. So disciples help others follow Jesus. Number four, I'll wrap up quickly. Disciples intentionally invest in meaningful relationships. Disciples intentionally invest in meaningful relationships. Paul tells young Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 and 2, he said, you therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these things to faithful men who are able to teach others. And so Paul's telling Timothy, hey, don't just store up all the things I've been teaching you in your brain and sit on it. Take the things that I've been teaching you and teach others. But be wise about it, okay? Teach others who are going to be able to teach others. Means investing in meaningful relationships. And we see this throughout Scripture. Moses invested in Joshua. Eli invested in Samuel. Eli wasn't the best example, really. His family life was a little sketchy. But there was at least one moment when Eli got it right. And it came about in 1 Samuel chapter 3, and the story goes like this. Samuel was a young boy living in the temple with Eli. Eli had been, you might would say, Eli had been discipling him in the ways of the priesthood. Eli's a young boy, and he's going to sleep, and he hears a voice. He thinks it's Eli, so he hops up and he runs to Eli. Eli says, what are you doing here? It wasn't me. Go back to bed. He goes back to bed. He hears the voice again. He runs to Eli. Eli's like, no, it wasn't me. Go back to bed. He goes back, lays down, hears a voice. Gets up, runs to Eli, and finally, Eli gets it right. And he says, Samuel, third time, I think I know what it is. I think God's trying to speak to you. And so you go back, you lay down. When you hear the voice this time, you say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And that's a lot like discipleship. It's a lot like sitting down with people and helping them determine what God is speaking to them about today. What God is trying to tell them today. About their job, about their marriage, about their parenting, about whatever they're dealing with, their finances, all these different areas. Elijah invested in Elisha. Jesus invested in the 12. Jesus invested even more in the 3, Peter, James, and John. Paul invested in Timothy. We see it all throughout scriptures. Disciples intentionally investing in meaningful relationships. And so I ask you this morning, if you're a believer of Jesus Christ, are you investing in anybody else's life? Here's another question for you. Is anybody investing in your life? And that's an important question too, because I'll tell you from personal experience, life had gone pretty good for a while, but a few years ago, when things went sideways in Nicaragua, things kind of went sideways in my life too, and I had a lot of uncertainty, and it caused a lot of fear, it caused a lot of anxiety, it caused a lot of stress. And I realized I didn't really have anybody speaking into my life. 45, been in ministry for 25 years, been saved since I was 6, but I needed someone to speak into my life. I had to go find somebody. And I've got an older man who served as a missionary, who actually lives out on the West Coast, who calls me and talks to me about every 2 weeks. And we just talk about what's going on in life, and he usually shares a few verses from Scripture and encourages me. Somebody speaking in your life? Are you speaking into somebody else's life? That's what discipleship is about. And wrap up with this. Number 5, disciples depend on God for the results. A lot of times the excuse we use is, well, I don't know how to disciple somebody else. I don't know what book to use. You know, I didn't go to seminary. I don't really know how to study the Bible that well. Truth is, those are just excuses. You could just share whatever Pastor Mike preached last Sunday with them. You could break out our daily bread devotional and just sit down with somebody and say, hey, let's read this together. You could just, one verse of Scripture that maybe has stood out in your life over the past week, you just sit down and say, hey, can I share a verse of Scripture with you? This is what it means to me. But it's not dependent upon us. No matter how good or inadequate you might feel about discipling others, it still doesn't depend on us. John chapter 15, verse 5, Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Doesn't depend on us. Depends on Jesus. I like what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 5 through 9. Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers through whom you believed, as the Lord gave to each one? I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. Notice what he says. So then, neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters is anything, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters is one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. Doesn't depend on us. It depends on God. God has invited us to join him in what he's doing. He's just asking whether or not we're willing to be obedient. Are we willing to make disciples as we're going? If we are, he'll do the rest. We're his co-workers in the gospel. Let's pray. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity to worship you together here at South End. Thank you. For Pastor Mike, thank you for the leadership of this church. Thank you for those who lead worship. Father God, I pray for this church. Lord, I pray for churches all across North America, all around the world that are struggling right now, Lord, to figure out how to do church now and how to return to normal. Lord, a lot of things have been minimized and shut down and closed down, and there's a lot of activities that aren't being done that were once done. And Lord, would you help us as the body of Christ perhaps reevaluate what we're doing? Would you help us to perhaps consider that it's relationships and less about activities? It's more about being intentional, and it's less about being entertained. Lord, may we go back to the original ministry that you gave your disciples and us to do, and that being making disciples, helping others know you as Savior and grow in you so that they too can make other disciples. Lord, we ask for your help. And we ask that you would bless this church and use it for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.